Welcome to today's security webinar, How to Use Artificial Intelligence to Prevent Insider Threats. Today's webinar is brought to you by Intercept, an innovator in security analytics. In today's webinar, you will learn about the different types of AI security, including machine learning, neural networks, and deep learning. Which types of AI are better at detecting, different external and internal threats? How AI impacts existing security tools such as SIEM, DLP, or IAM, how to evaluate, when to use or not to use AI in your insider threat program, and best practices for deploying AI in your SOC environment. My name is Holger Schulze, and I'll be your moderator today. I am the founder and CEO of Cybersecurity Insiders, the 400,000 member online community for today's cybersecurity professionals. Joining me today is security expert and AI expert, Stefan Zhu, Chief Technology Officer for Intercept. Stefan, welcome to the program. Can you tell us a little bit about what you'll be presenting today?
Hi, Holger. Thank you for inviting me, and I'm happy to be here. At Intercept, we've been using AI and machine learning successfully for insider threat detection and prevention for almost 4 or 5 years now. And so what I'm excited to speak with you today and the audience is specific on that topic. What is AI? What does it do? What doesn't it do? Get a little bit technical into sort of the different aspects of AI and how it can be applied for insider threat detection, and suggest some key principles in which you can effectively deploy artificial intelligence and machine learning inside your environment.
Excellent. Thank you, Stefan. Now, during your first couple of minutes of today's webinar, let's take a look at some of the most interesting data points from the recent Insider Threat Report produced by Intercept and Cybersecurity Insiders, basically to reveal how insider threats are impacting organizations. Now, the first finding that stands out is that insider threats come in many forms. They originate within a company from, say, a malicious employee or a contractor, or they can stem from an accidental disclosure of sensitive data by a careless user. They can also manifest themselves as an external threat, such as phishing email or malware that infiltrates internal system and then uses unsuspecting insiders to accomplish its objectives. Not only is the incidence of these three main types of threats almost equal, right, if you look at the chart on the left-hand side, but our survey participants also confirm that all of these attack vectors are equally damaging, right, and need to be taken very seriously. Next, we asked our cybersecurity community about the biggest barriers to better insider threat management. And for the third year in a row, lack of training and expertise remains the biggest, single biggest barrier to better insider threat management at 52%. And the next critical barrier that we see here is the lack of suitable technology at 43%. By the way, that's showing a rapid, 15 percentage point gain compared to the previous year. This, to me, looks like employee awareness, right, and training, and also skill of cybersecurity professionals is an ongoing struggle, right, as employees are often the weakest link when it comes to insider threats, both on the side of employees being an insider threat, but also on the cybersecurity trying to protect their organizations against those threats. But what is notable is the rise in security technology being a bottleneck. Despite all the innovation and advances made over the years, many insider threats are still very difficult to detect and to differentiate from legitimate insider use. Stefan, let me ask you, why do you think organizations are still struggling with insider threats?
Well, insider threat, Holger, is a really hard problem to detect. And it's interesting when you cover the three different types of attacks on the earlier slides on the infographic, the three being external attackers, the malicious insider, or the accidental insider. In my simple mind, I think about the three types of bad guys. There's a bad guy on the outside, there's a bad guy on the inside, and then there's a stupid guy on the inside. But it's interesting because no matter which one of the three categories of attack happens, it turns out that many of them manifest themselves as an insider attack anyway. So whether it's compromised account where you've got a valid account that's being used for nefarious purposes, or where you have a subtle attack like APT, where there are signs of recon and lateral movement or an infected host that's happening inside your environment. These are all great examples of things that actually happen inside the network, not outside. And so because they're inside the network, what you're dealing with is a case where you've got authorized applications running authorized access to data, connecting to authorized machines that they're authorized to, but they're still doing bad things, right? So access control doesn't apply. Standard rules-based methods doesn't apply. Instead, you need to rely on much more sophisticated techniques to be able to do that. What isn't helpful is the fact that we actually have a lot of systems and a lot of data that actually gives us the ability to detect that information. But unfortunately, we typically do not have enough humans to be able to process all of that information that these systems are emitting. So the challenge typically I find isn't the fact that we lack the data. We have plenty of data. We've got tons of DLP applications. We've got lots of endpoint data. We've got really rich network information flowing into our SIMs. The challenge is the fact that we don't have enough humans to be able to look at all these log files, to look at all the clues, to look at all these alerts and process them all and figure out the separation between a valid collection of alerts versus those that are much more interesting. It's not that a human can't do it. We have many smart humans on our teams, but the challenge really is we don't have enough of them. Humans need sleep. Humans need rest. Humans can't have the ability to keep up with the billions of rows of data, the tens of billions of rows of data that are flowing in daily into your systems. And we will never have enough people to be able to staff up to solve that issue. So when I look at the challenges on the right-hand side for the various types of people that you have in your SOC, on your security teams, what I see as the promise of AI is somehow being able to use automated machines, automated statistics and mathematical methods to be able to do what a human would do if you had enough of them. And that will give you unprecedented focus and visibility into the risk that's inside your system.
Yeah, thanks, Stefan. I think your analysis is spot on. Let me ask you this. You mentioned visibility. Who, in your opinion, would most benefit from better visibility right into those, you know, threats across systems and data sets? And how can AI help with that?
That's a great question, Val. And when I look at the characteristics of the people that would benefit the most, in other words, the bullets on the right-hand side of this diagram, what I see in the 4 years that we spent in the space is that basically almost everyone can benefit from this visibility. It's really interesting. Over the past 4 years, we've learned that there is no real single vertical where our customers lie. Our customers expand a wide gamut from everything from defense contractors to military organizations to companies, large companies in the energy sector or large telecom companies to video game companies, right? A good example, which I'm able to sort of talk about publicly, is a company called Midnight Oil. They're an ad agency for Disney, so they're involved in the Star Wars movies, for example. And Mark Squire, the director of security at Midnight Oil, basically installed Intersect and is quoted as just being thrilled at our ability to take billions of events and distill them down into a small number of high-confidence security intelligence. And that's kind of the promise of AI. By approaching this problem of too much data, too much information, too many systems, with the right set of mathematical approaches, you really can focus and give you visibility that you'd be surprised that is actually doable with, again, the right approaches. And of course, what we're trying to solve is the fact that there are limitations to the current tools. It's not that they're bad. It's just that there are ways in which we can take the information that these tools are already collecting and already emitting and actually deal with the challenges of having too much false positives, an overwhelming amount of data, not enough focus, and certainly not enough staff to deal with the data that is being produced. And that's really where artificial intelligence can, I believe, come to play. And, you know, using artificial intelligence to solve this problem is very promising. And I think that's why, in my opinion, this is so interesting to cybersecurity professionals today. There was a recent survey from Forrester where it's, as you can see here, you know, just thinking about using AI and following through on the promise of AI to help mitigate security risk, 34% of our industry believes this is something that's really important for them to implement on in the next year. And in fact, the stakes are higher than ever. AI is obviously not a silver bullet, nothing is, but boy, oh boy, can it really help your teams. And it's a tool to help give your smart humans the ability to focus and be visible to the risk inside your environment. They really deserve that technology. AI can be a really powerful weapon for the force of good when properly implemented.
Thank you, Stefan. And I guess now is probably a good time to perhaps take a step back and help our audience understand some AI concepts. Can you help us understand what is AI and, you know, what types of AI exist?
Yeah, for sure, Holger. It's funny. So sometimes when people think about artificial intelligence or they hear all these fancy terms, it quickly becomes overwhelming. But to me, it's actually quite simple. So I'm going to compare artificial intelligence to something that each and every one of you folks in the audience already understands really, really well. And that's human intelligence. Because artificial intelligence is nothing more than the ability to simulate what we as humans already do quite naturally. So when I think about human intelligence, I can sort of divide it up into three buckets. And you kind of read this system diagram here from left to right. So on the left, we have one bucket for how humans, when they are sort of processing the world around them, and that's kind of the input column, right? So there are data sources out there like the light spectrum that sort of governs how you see. There are things that you are hearing through your ears and you're processing people talking to you. So there's obviously an aspect of intelligence where we as humans are perceiving the world around us and turning light signals and noise and sounds and pressure points on our sensors, like our hands, and turning that into information. And so there's a category of artificial intelligence techniques that is all around processing input. So these are things like NLP and speech recognition and visual recognition and recognizing objects in a scene and trying to determine the contents of a video frame and so on and so forth. So as an input set of technologies, you might have heard of some of these terms, and I think that's pretty clear that that's sort of what's happening in that spectrum. In the middle, we have, as human intelligence, a set of processing that we do. We have knowledge and memory systems where we are figuring out rules around the world around us and storing that information in a specific way. We have decision and inference systems where we are making decisions, targeting a specific goal, and then acting in our best interest to achieve that specific goal. We also have the ability to learn. We are, without being given explicit rules like learning arithmetic, we are learning every day as we grow. More around the world around us. We're learning about people, we're learning about the objects that we observe through our input systems. And so these three areas, again, have exact analogs inside the world of artificial intelligence. There are knowledge and memory systems like knowledge representation and ontology research and storing information in graph databases about the world around us. Those are all very strong, very interesting areas of AI research. We also have branches of AI that focus on decision and inference. How do we make the best possible decision, optimizing towards a specific goal, given the information that we have around us? And of course, there's learning. So the analog of learning in human intelligence is what we call machine learning. And I'll dive deeper into this specifically because it's so relevant to the problems that we face in cybersecurity today. But essentially, machine learning is how we can sort of learn about the world around us, make reasoning and decisions about the world around us without being told explicitly what the steps are. That's really what machine learning is. And then, of course, the last and final bucket on the right-hand side is output. How do we take the results of all this processing and do something with it? And this is where we get into areas like robotics and self-driving cars and the generation of speech, like what happens when you have a conversation with Siri. And in our case, the flow basically is talking about, if you look at the orange bottom of this diagram, what's interesting to us is how can we go from cybersecurity data sources to do machine learning to generate threat leads. So in our case, the approach that I'm about to outline here in the rest of this presentation is really on how we can take these aspects of artificial intelligence and apply them to the problem at hand. Let's talk a little bit about machine learning. I'm not going to lecture you for an hour here, but I think it's worth explaining just a little bit so that we're kind of on the same page. And we can also come to a common realization that all these fancy buzzwords, they're important, but they're really not as as tricky to understand as I think sometimes the marketing literature makes it sound like. So there are two main categories of machine learning, as you can see here. There's supervised learning and there's unsupervised learning. And basically the difference between the two is whether you're learning using examples that are provided to you or you're learning without examples. And let me give a quick example. So supervised learning, this is when you're learning by example. So you've got a data set and that data set has known examples inside that data set. And that those examples, they're called labels by the data scientists. Those labels essentially become the examples that allow you to get better at the task that you're attempting to learn. So an example would be if I had a kid who was young enough that they didn't know the difference between cats and dogs. And then I present to that young child a series of animals and I tell that child, this is a cat, this is a cat, this is a cat, and this is a dog, this is a dog, this is a dog. So those labels, cat, 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 dog, 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 is basically enough information where a human intelligent system could actually eventually learn the difference by observing these differences between what was he or she was told was a cat versus what he or she was told was a dog. So in this example, that human child might eventually say, hey, you know what? I've noticed that cats always meow and dogs always bark. Basically over time, with enough data, with examples of cats and dogs, that kid will probably come up with a pretty good algorithm to eventually learn to tell the difference. That's learning by example. That's a good example of supervised learning in action. Unsupervised learning is when you're learning basically by discovering the pattern by yourself, but without being told that this is a cat and this is a dog. So in this case, let's take that same example. Let's suppose instead of telling the child that this is a cat and this is a dog, let's suppose that we just show the child a collection of animals. And the animals happen to be made up of only cats and dogs. And you can imagine how that child over time might notice, hey, you know what? There appear to be two categories, two clusters of animals in this crowd. Some of them always meow, and some of them always bark. Some of them have sharp, pointy ears and long tails. Some of them don't tend to have pointy ears, and they tend to have shorter tails, and so on and so forth. That kid might not know that they're called cats and dogs, these two groups that he or she has discovered on their own, but essentially he has learned the fact that there are these patterns within the group of animals. So it's a little bit more sophisticated, but in practice, humans tend to learn through a combination of by example and by pattern discovery. Okay? Now, when you sort of break down the different algorithms that implement machine learning, there's actually a large number of algorithms. You see some of them listed here. Some of these algorithms are literally hundreds of years old. But and this is a pretty simplified view, to be honest. But the idea here is that there is a large catalog of techniques and methods that can be used to perform both supervised and unsupervised learning methods. And a really common one that we've heard about quite a bit in the space recently is, of course, deep learning. Deep learning has deservedly gotten a lot of praise in the market for some of the amazing advances that it has done. Deep learning is actually an example of neural networks. So you might recognize the term neural networks. This is actually something that is, based on ideas that began in the 1940s, so quite a while ago. And it really reached the heyday inside the 1980s, where neural networks made some great advances in, for example, handwriting recognition, processing zip codes to quickly and efficiently identify your address and where to route the package and so on and so forth. So deep learning as an extension of neural networks is not really a new technique. And we'll talk a little bit in a couple of slides why it's actually different and interesting and relevant today. But back in the 80s, this was the general idea. They were trying to, when they created the neural network technique, to base it on how they believe the human intelligent brain worked. And so we believe, for example, and we still believe today, that humans learn primarily through collections of neurons that talk to each other, and that the strength of the connection between neurons is one part of what allows us as humans to learn. And so what you see here is a mathematical representation of that system that I just described. And the idea here is you have these circles, which are representing the different neurons of a neural network, or in your brain in this case. Every neuron, every circle, sometimes called a node, represents one of these potential cells that's doing processing inside an intelligent system. The input flows on the left-hand side, as you can see here, and the output flows out on the right-hand side. And so there are signals that come in on the left-hand side that correspond to the input data set. And then there are results that come out on the right-hand side that corresponds to the answer. And basically, there's math that occurs inside the circles, inside the nodes, and inside these lines, these edges or these synaptic connections, where the math eventually allows the system to learn. And the way it generally works is you present the input to the left-hand side, you look at the output on the right-hand side, and in the very beginning, when you have a brand new neural network that hasn't yet learned anything, you'll essentially get a random output. But you can compute the difference between the output and the label. This is why this is an example of learning by example. And based on the difference, you can basically adjust the math inside the neural network so that the neural network does better next time. And once you give it enough examples, then you will eventually converge the output so that it starts to match more and more closely the examples that you have in your data set. And then voila, when you've done that enough times, you will have a neural network that has learned to match the input to the desired output based on example data set. Obviously, this is an example of supervised machine learning because we do rely on a data set that that has answers stored in it. But it also highlights one of the important things about neural networks. The data really matters. And there's a great story around the 1980s neural networks that really illustrates why the data is so important. And, it's quite possible that this story might be an urban legend, but I have to say it was told to me by Jeff Hinton when I was at the University of Toronto. And Jeff Hinton is one of the fathers of deep learning today. So it's a story that's worth repeating and learning from. So here's the general idea. The way it works is the Pentagon created a neural network to try and teach the algorithm to learn the difference between tanks and trees. So given a picture of a tank or a tree, the neural network, when properly trained, should be able to say immediately, hey, this is a tank, or hey, this is a tree. Now, back in the 1980s, we didn't have the large compute systems that that we have available today. So instead, they were pretty limited in how much compute power they had. In particular, they had one single mainframe upon which they could simulate this neural network. So the neural network actually wasn't that huge. But they were able to train the neural network in the lab on 200 photographs, 200 pictures. And so they sent the pixels of the pictures into the input layer. They got the output layer to eventually say either tank or tree. And it was fantastically well behaved inside the lab. They would show it a picture and the neural network would instantly say either tank or tree. And it was almost 100% accurate. So the Pentagon was thrilled. However, when they took the neural network to the field, the results were actually disastrous. You know, they point the camera at a picture of a tree and basically it'll say tank and vice versa. And they actually went back to the lab and they tried to figure out what went wrong. And it turned out that what went wrong was if you look at the original input data set, they realized that all of the pictures of the tanks were taken under different lighting conditions than all of the pictures of the trees. In fact, all tank pictures were taken under cloudy conditions, whereas all tree pictures were taken in sunny conditions. And so what the neural network had actually learned was to be able to tell whether it was sunny or cloudy based on the color intensity of the pixel. So, you know, this to me just highlights the importance of data. But you know what? This isn't the 1980s anymore. This is a brand new world. And so there's actually a lot of improvements that we have available to us. In particular, we have much more than a single mainframe that we can do computations on. We can have thousands of computers running tens of thousands of calculations. We can have hundreds of thousands of computers running millions or billions of calculations, much more than ever before. We also have the ability to, in some cases, get more data than ever before. Instead of just 100 pictures of tanks and trees, we can get hundreds of thousands of hours of video per day on YouTube, right? That's a lot more pixels, that's a lot more data. And the more data, the better some of these algorithms can become. There's also better algorithms. So the neural network that we used back in the 1980s, they're all variants of a simple backprop network. There are lots more algorithms available now. Here are some examples here that are related to neural networks, but this extends to more than just neural networks, just machine learning in general. There's a fantastic body of research, and that's largely the result of some of the broad investment and excitement around artificial intelligence and machine learning in general. There's so much that we can do with AI, not just for cybersecurity, but inside cybersecurity specifically, I would say that nothing more is at stake and nothing more holds greater promise.
Excellent. Thank you, Stefan. Now that we know, you know, what AI is and why it holds such promise, you know, for solving some of the most difficult security problems, the question is, how can we effectively apply AI to specifically to insider threats?
That's great. And as I said earlier, there's almost been a renaissance of AI. And we've seen that renaissance in other domains. We've seen that renaissance happen inside companies like Amazon and Microsoft and Google for so many exciting applications, from speech recognition to image recognition to video processing to medical healthcare and medical analysis and diagnosis. So why not insider threat detection? And the answer is, of course, it makes total sense. There are actually five key ingredients that I would say are important for effective application of artificial intelligence for insider, or as I like to call it, inside threat detection. Because remember, most of these use cases end up becoming inside threats regardless. And the first key ingredient, I think, is to pick the right algorithm for the job. And for insider threats, it's really important to consider what I like to call unique normal.
Yeah, exactly. What is unique normal and how do you measure it?
That's a great question. Yeah, unique normal is basically the concept that you don't want to try and average your entire population together. So this is really important for the reduction of false positives. So let me give an example. If you had a large population of users, every user is different. Every human is different. Everyone is unique. So you want to be able to understand what normal is for every individual uniquely, because what is unique and different and normal for Bob is going to be different than what is unique and normal and different for Mary, right? So the right way of thinking about technique like anomaly detection, which is a way of sort of measuring normal and then looking for difference and deviations from that normal behavior, it is not fair to try and compute normal across a across the entire population. So suppose you wanted to have an understanding of what the average time that a person comes into work is. That's going to be different for every single one. So to try and take all 100 employees, all 1,000 employees, even worse, all 10,000 employees inside your environment and average it up together into a single time, that's going to generate a lot of noise because everyone is uniquely different. So when the person that always comes in at 11:30 comes in, you don't want that to give you a false positive. So what's important is to be able to use large-scale machine learning to measure normal for every single person individually. So that's what I mean by unique normal. It's recognizing the fact that normal is unique for every single one. That's sort of key ingredient number one. Key ingredient number two is to rely on something that is better served by unsupervised machine learning. And this is particularly important for insider threat. Recall that supervised learning is done when you're learning by example. And that means that we need a large amount of data, and that data needs to ideally be labeled. That is the best situation for supervised learning approaches to be effective. And there are cybersecurity use cases where we have that rich set of data that we're looking for. The best example is malware. You know, we have lots of examples of malware. We have lots of examples of malicious binaries. We can detonate them inside a virtual environment. We can sort of measure what the behaviors of malware look like and compare that to the behavior of innocent binaries. And so we have lots of examples of cats and dogs inside this example. That doesn't exist for many insider threat use cases. You know, no one has ever been able to give me a data set of, say, Active Directory records and then say, you know what, here's an Active Directory log file and there are exactly 5 and only 5 insider threats inside it, and here they are, right? We have a much more difficult problem ahead of us because the data is somewhat limited. They are typically unlabeled. They're not as clean as the data that would really light up a deep learning system. And so what we need to rely on are other techniques, and primarily they are supervised learning. Right? This is where the automatic discovery of patterns, which doesn't rely on clean data or well-labeled examples, that's a good approach. And that is sort of key principle number 2 for me. Now, combine these two things together, unique normal and unsupervised machine learning, and you end up with a system that requires what I call key ingredient number 3. And that's a big data infrastructure. There's a lot of calculations that's happening here. And we also want to be able to, in order to increase efficacy, take advantage of all the clues out there. We don't want to just process Active Directory data. We want to be able to combine all the clues in Active Directory with all the clues in NetFlow, with all the clues in your file share data, with all the clues inside your DLP system, and so on and so forth. So we need both big data storage and big data compute, and it has to be cost effective. And so part of key principle number 3, that big data infrastructure to me, is to rely as much as possible on open source, battle tested, horizontally scalable, cost effective technologies like the technologies that you see here. So using technologies like Hadoop and Phoenix and Spark and Kibana and Elastic basically allows you to be able to collect data from a wide variety of sources to create those unique normal baselines across a large population of entities whether it's a user or a machine or an IP address or a printer, be able to quantify differences, meaningful differences from each one of these unique normals, and then be able to sort of combine them together in a mathematical infrastructure to be able to correlate all those clues together into a small number of high quality leads. And we've been able to see this in action a number of times over the years, and it is amazingly effective. But the only way we can sort of do this effectively is by having a technology infrastructure that is able to sort of process all this information at scale and do it in a cost-effective manner. And that's why the big data infrastructure is so important. Now, I just alluded to the fact that you need a mathematical infrastructure as well. So along with this technology infrastructure that you see here, which takes in data on the left-hand side and then produces those high-quality threat leads on the right-hand side, you need an equivalent mathematical structure to do the same thing. So mathematically, here's what's happening. We have all of these data sources out there. This is just an example using repository, Active Directory, and VPN. But in practice, any combination will work here. All of these data sources have these clues. This is what a data scientist would call features. These are the input columns into your mathematical models, into your machine learning models. So these clues can all be extracted automatically by your security analytics system. So for example, in this example here, you might extract clues around how much N typically accesses in terms of volume. You might derive another clue around which combinations of file folders N typically access. You might derive information from VPN around what location N typically VPNs from and what time of day she typically logs in at, and so on and so forth. All these clues can be sent into machine learning models that are all unsupervised, but serve the purpose of quantifying when something unusual happens. So these models can be trained on historical data to be able to learn and detect when N does something that is out of normal. The output of all of these models end up being probabilities, which essentially tell you when something highly unusual and risky happens. And then there's a second layer of mathematics that computes a very important number, and that's called the entity risk score. The idea here is that you want to not look at every one of these clues in isolation, like an alert in a SIM. That's not going to be helpful. Because if you just looked at one single item here, for example, noticing that Anne just logged in at the usual time of day, well, maybe she logged in at 1 o'clock in the morning because she has a deadline due tomorrow and she's burning the midnight oil. But if she also moves an unusually large amount of data and she also accessed a large number of file folders more than anyone else inside her group and accessed file folders that she'd never accessed before and also VPN from China, and that was unprecedented. It's a combination of all these clues together that makes Anne a person of interest. And that's what that last part of math on the right-hand side does automatically. So there's math that you can deploy that sort of connects the dots between all these data sources on these clues and gives you a single number that allows you to filter out and identify that high-quality lead. And that's a mathematical framework that is really useful. And that's key principle number four. So these four ingredients combined together is really what you need. You need to compute unique normal. That's especially important for insider threat. You need unsupervised machine learning because that's better for the types of data involved in these insider attacks. You need a big data infrastructure because you need to be able to compute this stuff at scale in real time in a cost-effective manner. And you need to have a mathematical framework to be able to compute this entity risk score, to be able to take the billions or tens of billions of events every day and reduce it down as you move from the left to the right into a small number of high quality leads. And that's really important. There's a bonus key technique, and that's actually our user experience. So whether our customers use our UI or not, for example, they might just rely on taking our output and processing that into their SIM and will continue to use their single pane of glass. But for those that use our UI, they actually find that to be very helpful. especially since you actually don't want to require someone having a PhD or background in data science to be able to understand these analytical results. You can appreciate all the things that the math is doing without having to be a mathematician yourself. And you do that through a UI. So in our screenshot, for example, here just to illustrate kind of the principles I've already outlined, this is all the different ways, all the different entities in the system that we're measuring unique normal for. So you can see that this really is a big data issue. And whether you have 12,000 users in the population, as you see here, or you know, several orders of magnitude more than that, the benefit of being able to go from millions or billions on the left-hand side to a small number of higher quality leads, 5 billion down to 29 in this case, that's super valuable. And this math does scale. Where we have a customer that is analyzing a million entities or a billion entities, we always manage to get down into a small number of high quality leads for them. And of course, that enterprise risk score that I mentioned earlier, the entity risk score, computing a single number to identify your risky users, your risky machine, that really is useful and critical to be able to separate the important stuff from the stuff that you can ignore. And this math really does work, right? So here's a single anomaly, a single model in action. This is completely unsupervised, so there's no human information that was ever provided. But as you can see here, we've learned in the sort of top half of this diagram what the normal expected amount of outbound email in this simple example is for this particular user, yaman@intrusion.com. And so the bar that shows the current observed behavior, the 960 gigabytes, clearly out of norm, and in this case, wildly out of norm. So this is a very sort of obviously straightforward example. But compared to the past, compared to the others like this user, both obviously out of normal. Here's maybe a more interesting example. That same type of technique to compare you to past behavior and compare you to others like you and looking for quantifiable differences in them can also be used for more than just email-based exfiltration, but think about using it for insider fraud detection through the submission of fraudulent expenses, right? So in this example here, this is data from one of our larger customers. This particular user made a number of fraudulent claims in the entertainment category in the expense system, but it was unusually high, not just for that particular employee, but compared to others. So similar mathematical technique, but obviously kind of a different use case, but both inside the insider threat realm. Sometimes it's almost too simple that the visualizations lead you to believe that, you know what, I can see how I could do this myself. I could just compute means and standard deviations and see when something is unusually high. But to be honest, you know, that technique, as you might have learned it in high school, really doesn't work so well. So I always like to leave an example of something that's a little bit less intuitive as to sort of how you might be able to use math to solve this problem. So here's a good example here, something that is one of our more sophisticated models. So this particular machine, QA Win 7 Con, was slightly unlikely to have human activity at this hour, but TCP 465 was used, which is weakly associated with human activity. This behavior is very indicative of anomalous non-human scripted activity. So this is an example of a set of techniques that we have inside our solution where we found that using the right statistics, it's actually possible to learn to discriminate between human behavior and non-human behavior, like that of a script or a bot. And that is incredibly useful. It's always interesting when something that was previously human all of a sudden starts to behave like a non-human and vice versa. In this example here, this is for those that are sort of in this particular space, this is clearly an example of a spam bot infection. TCP 465 is probably an outbound SMTP traffic, and you can see that the machine learning models here has learned that for this particular machine, TCP 465 is something that is normally used during certain hours of the day, but not at 4 to 5 a.m. And this is a change in behavior that is indicative of a non-human switched activity, which in this case, as I mentioned earlier, is probably a spam bot infection. It's very tempting to look at this text and think that this was some sort of rule that was defined by a human, you know, but I assure you this is not. This is something that is 100% learned from the environment. Because, and you need to, right? You remember unique normal. What if this was a machine that wasn't being used as an outbound SMTP server? What if that machine had been configured not to use TCP port 465, but some other port? You can't rely on rules to be able to define this because that just increases the load and the maintenance on your human teams. This is all something that you can do automatically using statistics.
Stefan, so this is quite interesting. And just a quick question, if I could insert that here. Now, since the technology, as you said, right, can detect anomalies in behavior, right, and can differentiate between, say, humans and bots, can the technology perhaps also detect, say, malware and protect, you know, against that?
Absolutely. And you can sort of think about this example here as the ability to sort of discriminate between humans and non-humans. And you can extend that to things like, well, here's a process that is normally behaves a certain way because it's tied to a human user that's running it, but now it's behaving differently. Or here's a process that never historically had a dependency on wininet.dll, but all of a sudden it does. That's unusual. Or here's a program or a machine that typically would have a very sort of human driven or random usage of the network connection. But all of a sudden you see a very repeatable time signature pattern inside the outbound network connection, almost like a beaconing of a C2 piece of software that got installed. So there are lots of examples where this type of technique can be used to detect malware. All right. Well, let's summarize and sort of step back. There's actually a lot of things that we can do with AI. And so what you see here is kind of the same diagram that we showed earlier, but now with the addition of AI. So these are the same use cases on the left, same human teams on the right. What's different is by adding AI to the problem set, by adding AI to the set of weapons that we have to apply to the problem, there's a change in what we can do. There's a change in the visibility and the ability for the CISO to be able to take advantage of existing security investments. You can take advantage, finally, of all the data and all the systems that you already have deployed inside your environment. There's a change in the ability of the security architect to be able to get visibility into the risk, to be able to fulfill the promise of all the security tools that were perfectly implemented, but were just generating too much information. There's a change in the way the security practitioner can actually triage all this information and more effectively take advantage of the tools and AI to be able to better focus and spend his time doing the really important stuff and tracking down the high risk insider threats and not worry about the noise that could otherwise be there. And AI really does help you connect the dots between all these use cases. It really does become a really powerful utility for you to be able to take a large amount of information and get that small number of high quality leads without deploying any rules, without deploying any thresholds, essentially with orders of magnitude lower human involvement required and maintenance required compared to, say, a traditional multi-rule definition rule pack exercise inside a SIM. This is a completely different approach that we're really proud of here. And quite frankly, at Intrusion, we've seen a lot of success with over the past 4 years. So this is what we do. I'm really excited to be talking to you guys about this today. We've been doing this, like I said, for about 4 years now. The security analytics, the machine learning, this highly scalable big data platform that we have, that is the result of 100 hours of investment that we've made as a company into the R&D and the math and the big data technologies and our user experience. We've got offices in Ottawa and Newport Beach in California, and we're just incredibly proud to be able to sort of help out this space. This is a space that's really important to us, and we truly believe that the right mathematical approach, the right data science, can really be a powerful component of what we're all trying to do together here. And I think at this point, I'd like to hand it back over to you, Holger, and maybe we've got some questions that we can take from the audience.
Excellent. Thank you, Stefan. First, this is truly fascinating, right? And I can't wait for some of the audience questions. Stefan, the first question, how does machine learning and AI reduce false positives?
That's a great question. Compare your technique to a human. Well, a human would reduce false positives by not just relying on a single clue. That human would take multiple clues and sort of correlate them together in his head. So if you call my early example around the Ann account logging in unusual hour, VPNing in from China, touching file folders that he or she never accessed before, and so on and so forth. So you want multiple clues that's connected together. In our math framework, the one that I recommend, you can do that automatically. Use machine learning, use artificial intelligence, use algorithms to be able to not rely on a single alert or a single clue, but multiple clues and connect them together automatically. In our UI, we call that the entity risk, and that we found is a very sort of simple and straightforward concept to allow you to sort of filter out all the noise. And what you end up with is a very sort of low false positive set of those high quality leads.
Very nice. Thank you, Stefan. The next question, how does your solution assist with the identification of zero-day exploits?
That's a great question as well. Zero-day exploits are sort of famously difficult to detect because the historical methods allow around sort of hard-coded signatures, right? So there's a signature, maybe it's based on the very first time that someone notices a particular piece of malware, and that signature is essentially hard-coded to a blacklist, and then you're looking for future occurrences of that thing. A zero-day threat, by definition, is something brand new. We've really never seen this exact example before. But you know what is consistent across zero-day threats? It's their behaviors. Right. So even though this is a brand new binary and you've never seen it before, security experts, really smart humans, they can identify zero-day threats because they behave differently in measurable ways, right? So there's a predictability to the behavior of binaries. You know, they should never reach out to the internet this way. They should never be connecting to this database this particular way. They should never be accessing this part of memory this way. That is new behavior, that is an anomaly. So the approach that I'm describing here basically would capture those types of zero-day threats because you would have models that are looking for changes to those behaviors. And in every one of the examples that I just gave, there's a behavior change that can be detected, quantified, and then used to identify even the zero-day threat.
Thank you, Stefan. It looks like we have time for one more question. And the question is, if an account has already been compromised before you receive the data set, how will your solution identify the compromise?
Another great question. So this is the concept of you've got a bad guy, for example, if I just pick on humans for a second. So you've got a bad guy in the data set. He's been bad from day one. He's always been bad. How can you find him? And the secret here is you don't rely on just looking for behaviors that are anomalous with respect to the past, right? And if the bad guy has always been bad, then you're not gonna see any difference there. But you do, you can catch them by building models that compare that person to others. So in this case, the bad guy, if you do sort of peer comparisons compared to others like him, which is certainly something that we do very well here at Intrusion, that we find still allows you to sort of find those differences. So the bad guy, he might have always been bad, but he's still going to be behaving differently compared to others inside his environment.
Fascinating. All right. Thank you, Stefan. It looks like we're at the finish line for today's session. Now, as we're closing this webinar, I would like to thank everybody in our audience for joining us, and I hope you enjoyed today's presentation. I would especially like to thank you, Stefan, for sharing your insights on how artificial intelligence can help organizations reach new levels of efficiency and scale, and while significantly reducing the risk of an insider attack. Now, this concludes today's session. I hope we will see all of you again at one of our future webinars. Thank you, Stefan. Thanks, everyone.